the end of every December, as a matter of fact, every day, he gives us an opportunity for a new beginning. Tell someone, don't be discouraged. God has given another opportunity for a new beginning. Isaiah says, arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Somebody ought to rise in spite of confusion, in spite of grief, in spite of setbacks, in spite of difficulties. Arise and shine, for the light of Christ is risen upon us. That is what the Christmas season is about. The light of Christ has come.
Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through shadows dim, giving a light for those who long and mourn, and guiding the wise men on their way up to the place where Jesus lay. Beautiful star.
Oh, today, we are going out there and tell on the mountains, over the hills, and everywhere that Jesus is born. We're just going to sing that chorus a couple of times. Okay, join us.
The Lord of hosts. The earth is full. It's full of his glory. This is the day that the Lord has made. We've come. We've united. We, the people of God, we shall rejoice and be glad in it. We serve a faithful God. He's kept us throughout the year. He's brought us to this last Sunday in this year, 2021. What a faithful God. We are here. So we've come today. Those of us in the sanctuary. Those of us joining by way of live stream. We come to unite with one heart. One voice. One mind, one spirit to worship the name of the Lord, our God. This is that time of year when we commemorate the birth of Christ. The fact that heaven came down to earth for the salvation of lost mankind. So we're going to stay focused on what the reason for this season is truly all about. And we are going to worship God in spirit and in truth and in the very beauty of holiness. We begin this worship experience now as a congregation as we go into our opening hymn. We invite our moderator to lead us in our opening hymn at this time. Moderator Ishmael.
The prophet Isaiah says, arise, shine, for thy light is come. Is there light in this place today? Oh, let's sing and bring glory to the name of our God. Christians, awake, salute the happy morn whereon the Savior of mankind was born. Rise to adore the mystery of love, which hosts of angels chanted from above. With them the joyful tidings first begun of God incarnate and the Virgin Son. to sing, redeem the glad triumphant song. He that was born upon this joyful day, round us all his glory shall display. Saved by his love incessant we shall sing, eternal praise to heaven's almighty King. All praise belongs to our God. All worship, all honor. And this hymn contains the whole story. It's a story that needs to be told. Even though it's an old, old story, yet it is a story that is ever new. And even as we sung it in our chorus just now, go tell it on the mountain, we need to once again incorporate this story into our hearts and lives. We can't tell of a story unless we know about the story and what it is all about. This is a story of God's redeeming and saving lost mankind. Isn't that a good story? Are you ready to tell it? Are you ready to proclaim it? Are you ready to declare it? And let the whole world know that Jesus has come to redeem lost mankind. Oh, may we keep and ponder in our minds God's saving love towards mankind. Let's sing this final verse together. Then may we hope the angelic hosts among. Let's proclaim this story. It's very old, but still ever new. Let's praise and worship and honor our God for the mystery of his love in Jesus Christ.
Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Lord, we thank you for Emmanuel, God with us. With us to heal. With us to comfort, with us to bring joy, with us for those who are bereaved, to wrap your arms around them and tell them you will never leave them nor forsake them. Lord, you are aware that we, even as a congregation, are bereaved. Our first Christmas Sunday, in 39 years without our beloved Pastor Timothy Stewart, come by here and comfort us, Lord. So many families this year, Lord, said goodbye to loved ones, come by here and comfort those families, Lord. So many are perplexed in mind. Great Comforter, comfort them this morning. So many are financially challenged. You who claim that you will supply all of our needs according to your riches in glory by Christ Jesus, attend to those needs. Lord, it's in you that we live, move, and have our being. We thank you for life today. We thank you for life on this last Sunday of 2021. Recognizing that so many started the journey with us on the first Sunday of this year, but now their voices are hushed in death. We, being no better than they, just say thank you for your grace and your mercy toward us. Lord, as we come today for corporate worship, be with us. Lord, we want to worship you in spirit and in truth and the very beauty of holiness. Commune with us. As we sing, may our songs of praises reach heaven and be pleasing in your sight. And when your servant comes to this holy spot to proclaim your word, speak to us, Lord. You know what we need to hear. You know what we need. Meet us at the point of our needs this morning, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you are able to touch those in the sanctuary. You are able to touch those listening by live stream. Those on a sick bed this morning, touch, move, heal, strengthen, speak peace. We thank you, Lord, for an opportunity to worship you. Thank you, Lord, for this moment. May everything that is done in this service bring joy to you, Lord. We thank you that you are a God of another chance. So forgive us for our sins. We have erred this past week, erred in doing those things we ought not to have done, erred in failing to do things we ought to have done. Forgive us, Lord. And if there's one under the sound of my voice who does not know you as Lord and Savior, Lord, may this be decision day for that one. If there's one who knew you but have since slipped back, bring them back into the ark of safety, Lord, before it is too late. Emmanuel, God with us, thank you for being with us today. In Jesus' name we pray, and God's people say, amen.
Brightest, best of the stars of the morning, dawn on our darkness, lend us thine aid. Star of the east, the horizon adorning, guide where our infant Redeemer is laid. Let's sing together in response to that wonderful prayer today.
Oh.
sons of the morning. My brothers and sisters, it doesn't say second best. It is the best. Our Jesus is the best that God was able to offer. He offered himself. And we celebrate him on this one day after our Christmas celebration. We give God thanks. Philip said to Jesus, show us the Father and it will suffice us. Jesus says, Philip, he who hath seen me hath seen the Father. And Hebrews take it up like this. He says, he is the brightness of God's glory. And he is the exact representation of his person. And then he holds the whole world together by his hand. Isn't he the best? Isn't he the greatest? Best of all. Let's worship and praise our God as we sing this final verse together. Brightest and best of the sons of the morning is our Jesus. Let's sing about him and let's give thanks. If God has given us his best, let the church shout hallelujah.
Church, I firmly believe that the word of God is the only truth that exists. And it's important that we advantage ourselves of embracing that truth whenever we have an opportunity. And so I invite us at this time to turn our attention to the reading of God's word. And coming to read our Old Testament reading this morning, it's none other than our own sister, Shante Thompson. She will come at this time and read for us the word of God. That will be followed by our announcements that will be given by Reverend Lewis Hutchinson. God bless you.
Good morning, Bethel.
Let me ask us to kindly stand for the reading of the word. Thank you.
The first scripture reading is taken from the book of Psalms, chapter 67. God be merciful unto us, and bless us, and cause his face to shine upon us, that thy way may be made known upon earth, thy saving health among all nations. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. O let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for thou shalt judge the people righteously and govern the nations upon earth. Let the people praise thee, O God. Let all the people praise thee. Then shall the earth yield her increase, and God, even our own God, shall bless us. God shall bless us, and all the ends of the earth shall fear him. The word of the Lord.
As you worship in Bethel this morning, on behalf of our moderator, Ishmael Lightburn, and the leadership and membership of Bethel Baptist Church, we say, experience the fellowship of Bethel and leave knowing that you have felt the worship in Bethel. God bless you.
Amen. Let the church say amen. 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 Let us continue now as we invite Brother Craig Ferguson, he's coming now to bless our hearts with a solo. Amen.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy will one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Mary, did you know? Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again, the lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lord. Mary, did you know that your baby your baby boy will one day rule the nation? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect land? His sleeping child you're holding is the great boy.
One thing to be able to sing, and then it's another thing when you truly believe that what you're singing, and you sing it with conviction. I just thank Brother Craig, for he indeed blessed our hearts with that selection just now. Church, we continue now with our offertory period. At this time we ask the ushers to prepare now as we go into our time of giving. We're going to invite Deaconess Daff, if she would prepare to come and pray for the offering at this time.
Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we give you thanks. We thank you, dear God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, who died to save us from our sins. We thank you, Father, for giving him to us, Father God. And as you have given Jesus to us, Father God, we thank you. We will give back to you now a portion of that which you have blessed us with. Father God, as we give our tithes and our offering to you, God, Father, we ask that you bless it in the name of Jesus. We ask that you bless those that ushered. Father God, we ask that you bless those that would give. And Father God, may be used for the uplifting of your kingdom, upbuilding of your kingdom down here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, amen.
If you'd like to give to this ministry, there are four opportunities for you to give. One, you can give to us through our Royal Bank of Canada account, our main branch account, the account number 289-5688, or through our Bank of the Bahamas account. The main branch again, branch code 157, account number 135-000-1435. Otherwise, you can give through an internal transfer if you have a Royal Bank account or a Bank of the Bahamas account, a bank-to-bank transfer if you have online banking from another institution, or over-the-counter if you happen to be in one of those institutions and would like to make a deposit over-the-counter. Or if you'd like, you can simply go to our website, Historic Bethel Baptist, and click on our Give button. That will give you an opportunity to give via credit or debit card. And you can specify exactly which ministry you would like to give funds to so that we can direct those funds accordingly. God bless you.
Great.
Amen, Corral. God bless you. Come, let us worship the King. Anybody here today came to worship the King? Is he worthy of your praise? Amen. Amen. I invite us to stand at this time as we welcome Brother Aaron Neely, who will come and give us our second reading from the New Testament.
Good morning, church. The second scripture reading is taken from St. Luke chapter 2, verse 1 to 7. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The selection presented this morning by the chorale is based on the familiar carols brilliantly woven together by Van Denman Thompson to suggest the joy of Christmas.
Oh,
you, Chorale, for blessing our hearts so wonderfully with that rendition. Church, we've come to that time in the service when we're about to receive the Word of God. Anybody ready to hear the Word of God? Amen. If you came with an expectation this morning, let me just hear you say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Amen. With the exception of our visitor, our speaker this morning is no stranger to us. She's indeed one of us. She's homegrown. Amen? And she would not hesitate to tell you that she is the wife of our own Deacon Trevor Bethel, and that she is the mother of Amari and Adia. Amen? And that she is the daughter of our Sister Shirley. That she is the daughter-in-law of Reverend Patricia Bethel and Brother Georgie Bethel. Amen. And she is the sister-in-law of Sister Lisa Bethel. Amen. She is one of us. We thank God for her this morning. Our speaker this morning comes as one who is dedicated and committed to ministry. And what I love about her is that she is faithful to wanting to do that which God has assigned and tasked her with, and that is the preaching of the gospel. Amen? And so as she comes this morning, and I have no doubt that she has prepared herself, and I ask that you did come with an expectation, because I believe that she's going to drop quite a few nuggets with us today. And so I pray that you will pray along with me as I invite my sister in ministry, God's vessel for this time and this moment, Reverend Christina Bethell. Hear ye her.
Amen. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace to each and every one of you this morning. We give God thanks for our space here on this blessed, is it Christmas Sunday? Yeah. Christmas Sunday. Isn't God faithful? The last Sunday in the year. We honor the Lord for our moderator, Brother Ishmael Lightbond, Reverend Edward Hutchison, Reverend Christopher Brown, to all of our senior deacon and deaconesses on the pulpit, and to you, the body of Christ. Also honor the Lord this morning for my husband, Deacon Trevor. There is a word from the Lord this morning, and we want to just go straight into that. Bow your heads with me. Our God and our Father, you are so grateful. You are so wonderful and kind. You've kept us throughout the entire year, Lord. And for that, we say thank you. Thank you, Lord, for our space right here in Bethel. And Lord, even for those who are watching by way of social media, Lord. We thank you and we grab hold of what you have in store for us, even as the preached word of God is declared. Father, we have no word but your word. We cannot preach the word, Lord, or we dare not preach the word without your spirit and without your leading and your guiding, Lord. These are your people, Lord. And so as I stand here, Lord, Father, stand in me as I declare the word of God. May your people be blessed. May they be edified. May they be encouraged. May they be challenged. May you take Bethel and others who are watching to another place in you, Lord. Father, we thank you this morning for a spirit of expectation. We thank you for a spirit of joy. We thank you for a spirit of peace. We thank you that the word of God will make us richer, wiser, and better because of this preaching moment. Amen and amen. Amen. Well, this is the first Sunday, first Christmas Sunday, huh? Like Deacon Stephen Thompson said, in 38 years without our pastor and spiritual father. But you know, God is with us. Emmanuel, God is with us. Emmanuel, God with us. And I am so grateful that God is with us. Our text today comes from Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And we're going to read from the King James Version of Scripture. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Next verse. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice from henceforth even forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. This morning I want to preach from the sermonic text, Christ in Christmas. Christ in Christmas. We've come to worship on the final Sunday in the year of 2021. For many of us, this year has been one of confusion, chaos, great complexities, and conflicts. Humanity worldwide can attest to the strenuous burdens endured in 2021. Christians and non-Christians alike, nations and world governments, Fortune 500 countries, small companies, small businesses, families, barely any individual or organization have been excluded from the confusion, chaos, and great complexities and conflicts of 2021. Health systems globally endured to manage the crisis of COVID-19, and in the midst of that challenge, the Delta variant surfaced, and now they are forcefully fighting against the Omicron virus. Businesses have been severely affected. Countless employers experience economic hardship, being forced to shut their doors, while others had no choice but to downsize in order to survive. Governments had to increase their annual budgets to accommodate the massive unemployment rate globally. For some, in spite of the well-needed assistance received, homes were still repossessed, vehicles and valuable properties were still confiscated. 2021 has been beyond challenging, church. Healthy relationships were confronted with tension and anxiety. People were on the edge trying to cope with their own critical issues and those of their families. Mental health issues became a vital concern in the Bahamas. Domestic violence and child abuse escalated, particularly among women and children. There is an increase in homicide, and human trafficking is at an all-time high. Yes, even in our nation in 2021. Ecclesiastical leaders were overwhelmed by the numerous deaths of loved ones and friends, parishioners, having to be a source of strength and encouragement to others in grief, while silently suffering, working through their own personal grief. It's been a difficult year, church. Yes, 2021 will be an unforgettable year for Bethel as a congregation, as we struggle with the reality of the transitioning of our pastor and spiritual father. But, somebody say but. But, someone say but. Someone say yet. Yet in the midst of a year of confusion, chaos, complexities, and conflicts, God prepares the season of Advent for his bride, the ecclesia. In the midst of a difficult year, not only does God prepare the season of celebration for his bride through the coming of his son, but he also extends an invitation to the entire universe, the whole creation, to become partakers of this life-changing season. I want you to repeat after me. Advent has just passed. Yes, yes. Let's talk about the season of Advent,
The word Advent, Bethel, comes from the Latin word Adventus, which means coming. For the Christian church, Advent is a season of the birth of Christ and preparation for the second coming of the Messiah. We celebrate the birth and prepare for his second coming, a time when he shall rule over the world forever and ever, like the song that the senior choir sings, Handel's Messiah, and he shall reign forever and ever. The season of Advent, Bethel, reminds us that Christ is the central focus of Christmas. Christ in Christmas is an invitation to live life in Jesus. Many of us have been living life in ourselves and living lives on our own and living life for and by other people. But Christ in Christmas calls us to an invitation to focus on Christ. Christ in Christmas is an invitation to live life with new purpose and new meaning every day. God has given us another chance in spite of the year of confusion and the year of chaos and the year of great complexities and the year of conflict. God, at the end of every December, as a matter of fact, every day, he gives us an opportunity for a new beginning. Tell someone, don't be discouraged. God has given another opportunity for a new beginning. Isaiah says, arise and shine, for your light has come and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Somebody ought to rise in spite of confusion, in spite of grief, in spite of setbacks, in spite of difficulties. Arise and shine, for the light of Christ is risen upon us. That is what the Christmas season is about. The light of Christ has come. The light of Christ has come. Christ in Christmas causes us to understand that this last Sunday in 2021, God desires to do something fresh and new within us. Anybody tired of the same old thing? God desires to do something fresh. Isaiah says again, behold, a new thing is coming. A new thing shall spring forth quickly. Are you ready for it? God desires to do a new thing. The entrance of Christ into the world and in our lives is the opportunity for a new beginning and a fresh start. Christ in Christmas makes room in your heart for the Christ. I said that again. Christ in Christmas means that we ought to make room in our hearts for Christ. Make room in your hearts for Christ. Christ is the Messiah. Make room in your heart for his kingdom. Bible says Jesus, as he walked upon the face of the earth, Bethel, he said, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And during the season of Advent, what he's saying is, the kingdom of God is at hand. He's right here. He's available to you and to me. And we ought to receive him. Tell someone, make room in our hearts for Christ. See, Christmas is more than shopping and exchanging of gifts. Christmas is more than the beautiful lighted trees. Christmas is extended to all of us. The real gift of Christmas is the Son of the Highest. That's the gift of Christmas. The Son of the Highest, the Most High God gives, he's the Son of the Highest. And God sent him to have life and take room in your heart. And so the real gift of Christmas is Christ in Christmas gives you and me, or you and I, humanity, hope that is undeniable. Gives us a faith that is unmovable. Joy that is unspeakable. Peace that is inconceivable, incomprehensible. A peace that surpasses all knowledge and understanding. That's what happens when we take the time to see the Christ in Christmas. Revelation 3 and 20 says, and I know that it doesn't fit here, but I'm gonna make it fit. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Hermeneutic, it don't fit there. It don't fit there. But he says, behold, I stand at the door. That's what the Spirit just put in my spirit. I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. Knock, knock, knock. Advent and Christ in Christmas is a call for contemplative reflection for those under his lordship. It is a call for reflection and a call for us to hear him knocking and open the door and allow him to be one with, and allow ourselves to be one with him, one with the Father. Knock, knock, knock. Christ in Christmas, or the season of Advent, is a call to make room for Christ in your heart. Now in the Bahamas, he's on our lips and he's in our mouths. But this morning, is he truly in your heart? Is he truly in your heart? He told Peter, he said, Peter, do you love me? He asked three times. Peter said, Lord, you know I love you. Peter, do you love me? He asked again, Peter, do you? If you love him this morning, Bethel, make room in your heart for him. If you love him this morning, Bethel, take the time to spend with him. If you love him this morning, make God priority. Knock, knock, knock. This one is for the preachers, the ministers, the deacons, the ministry leaders, Bethel's executive board. It is a call to make room for Christ in our busy schedules. Many of us as leaders don't practice spiritual formation. Deaconess, we go on what we knew for many, many years. But this is a wake-up call, because you cannot lead God's people and govern his affairs if you don't have time for him. Oh, I'm busy preaching. I'm busy leading. I'm busy calling meetings. But how can you be trusted to lead the king's people if you don't have time for him? Preachers, ministers, auxiliary leaders, this last Sunday in the year, please hear me, our first calling is not unto preaching. It's not unto purpose. It's not unto leadership, Deaconess Keisha. Our first calling is unto intimacy with God. Our usefulness in ministry is determined by our spirit-formed lives. It is so. Our usefulness, and I'm talking to Bethel's leaders, our usefulness in ministry is not determined by your gifts. People are not changed because you can speak well, because you can preach well, because you could sing well, because you could dance well. No! People are changed by the Spirit of God upon you, and the Spirit of God that has been formed in you, and the Spirit of God that is being manifested through you. Make room for God. Knock, knock, knock. A call. situations and great complexities and all those other things. But how many of us establish a family altar in the midst of what we've all encountered this year? It's a call, husbands and wives and leaders. It's a call, young people, to make room for God in your family. It's another thing. In the ecclesiastical body worldwide, we want to lead God's people. We can't even lead our families. You can't keep your marriage together. You can't keep your children. I ain't talking about the grown children. I'm talking about the ones right there in the household who you leave sleeping. And you leave home sleeping. Let me tell y'all something. In Shirley Brown house, Deacon Hutchinson, Reverend Hutchinson, I didn't care how old you were. Not in my mother's house. That's why I thank God for the old school any day. My sister, when she had her first child, had already had a good job and went off to college, and I think she was probably almost 40, and the sisters had to call a family meeting. They're talking about the old school training now. How we can tell mommy this? We had to call a sisters meeting for a woman who was not even living in the household. That's the fear we had for her and the fear that she put in us for God. Man, we got to get it right. 2022, should the Lord allow us to enter into leadership, we got to first be better leaders over our lives and be better leaders over our families. I'm talking to everyone. I'm talking to myself. Then we can better lead God's people as an example. Make room for God in our families. Call a family altar. Call a time of prayer. Make room for God in your finances. Do you pay your tithes? I don't care how much do you make. Some make $100,000. Some make $10,000. Some make $50,000. But the real question is, do you pay your tithes? Do you give your offering? Yes, yes, this is a challenging message, Papa. Do you give your offering freely unto the kingdom of God? Do you support the causes of the local church that you are a member in? That's what it means to make room for God. Do you help the poor? You know, God is concerned about the poor. Make room for God in your health. Some of us need to stop consuming everything in God's holy temple, including me too. Someone in my house had three meals yesterday, Deaconess Maud. I only had one. I refused to, just one. Someone had three. Only had one, brother-ish. And I was determined I wasn't coming up here luggy. I had to preach. No, make room for God. I went in for one and a cup of tea. Three meals. And that ain't the leader. That's not even the leader. That's not the leader of our home. But then again, some will tell me, Rev, control your home. Control your home. Make room for God. In your health, a lot of our health problems is because we don't take the time to do what it is that we're supposed to do. In today's text, as I hasten to a close quickly, Isaiah wrote this prophecy at least 100 years before Israel was taken into the Babylonian captivity. Nearly 600 years before the birth of the Savior. See, Isaiah lived through a list of failed rulers and monarchs. Sitting in the rubbles of the Israel's monarchy, Isaiah looked across centuries to a time when God will rule the earth through his son Jesus, the Messiah, and he prophesied these words. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. For unto us, church, a child is born. Unto us, a son is given. The first point I want to make this morning is that Christ died for all. Christ died for all. For unto us, humanity, all who would accept the invitation to be a part of the Messiah's kingdom, all who will accept the gift of God that has come, all who will accept the opportunity to be representatives of the kingdom of God. Christ died for all. He is a savior and a deliverer for all who would submit to his lordship. All nationalities, all socioeconomic groups, all social classes, Christ has no gender bias. Christ has no political favorite parties. He has no favorite denominations or religion preferences. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world. Everybody say, he loved the world. Yeah, the Haitians that we mistreat, the Jamaicans that we mistreat, he loves all culture. He loves people. He loved the world. Christ died for all of us. Scripture says in Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sin. The NIV translation said he shall save the world from their sins. Not only did Christ die for all, but Christ can relate to all. Someone say, Christ can relate to me. Yeah, he died for all, but church, he can relate to all. For unto us a son is born, unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. We call this the hypostatic union. Christ was human and divine. Christ was human and divine. He was God, but yet he was also man. Christ, hypostatic union, a child is born, emphasizes the Messiah's humanity. He came to us as a human being in the form of a child so that he can relate to you. That's why Hebrews 4, it says, we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we were tempted, yet he did not sin. And so Christ is this high priest, this savior who knows what you are experiencing. He can empathize with you. And then he can also provide solutions for you. Right. Then a son of God will be given to us, implies the Savior's deity, his divinity. He existed before his birth as the second person of the Trinity. Remember? In the beginning, there was God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Son existed before his birth as the second person of the Trinity. And although he existed, Bethel, in the form of God, Philippians 2 says he thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but he emptied himself. He made himself of no reputation. The Son of God took on the form of a bond servant, being made in the likeness of man. So he was God in his divinity, and he was also God in humanity. But the point is, he can relate to you. Tell yourself, God can relate to me. The Christ child can relate to me. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. My second point is, Christ rules over all. He died for all. He can relate to all. And Christ rules over all. The government shall be upon his shoulder. The government will rest on his shoulder, church, affirms Christ's lordship. Let me ask you a question this morning. Is he Lord over your life? This verse speaks of a time in the future when Christ, he will reign over an earthly kingdom that encompasses all kingdoms and governments of the world. One day he will come and he will reign forever and ever. But it also speaks of today, the Messiah's rule over those of us who trust and obey him. And this rule is extended even to those who do not acknowledge him as Lord in their hearts. And so this morning, you ought to think, this is a thought for you to think about. Christ wants to rule in your heart. He wants to rule in your heart. You know, he is our Savior, but really, he's not many of our Lord. He saves us. He delivers us, but we have not made him Lord. And he wants to be Lord over our lives. And so Christ, he died for all. He can relate to all. Christ rules over all. And Christ's name is above all. The text says, his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. In the Lucan account of the scriptures, Luke 1:31, the angel Gabriel announced to Mary, behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, Yeshua, Joshua. And Jesus means the one who brings salvation, the one who delivers. You see, his name, y'all, was so important that the angel did not even trust God. Heaven did not even trust Mary to name him. He did not trust Mary to name Jesus because of the power and the authority that would have been in the name. The power and the authority that Jesus was born and was sent to earth to carry. Maybe Mary would have named him Joseph Jr. Maybe, perhaps. Yeah, or Jophesus, I don't know, something. Y'all know we mix up names. But the name was so important. The name was so powerful. The name had such, it was so rich. It had such an attachment to it that he did not even want earth to name it, Brother Toby. He said his name, heaven name it, shall be called Jesus. Jesus means a savior. One who brings salvation and one who brings deliverance. And Philippians 2 says, wherefore God has exalted him and given him a name which is above every other name. And that at the name, someone say the name, Jesus. And that at the name, Jesus, every knee shall bow of things in heaven and things in earth. And things under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of. That's how important this name is. If I had the time, I could tell you that at the name of Jesus, demons have to flee. If I had the time, Bethel, I could tell you that at the name of Jesus, cancer has to dry up and diabetes and it has to dissipate and high blood pressure have to be made low and have to be regulated. And at the name of Jesus, minds have to be transformed. If I had the time, I could tell you that your wayward sons and daughters at the name of Jesus can be set free. If I had the time this morning, Bethel, I can tell you that at the name of Jesus, all things is possible. His name shall be called Jesus. There is no name like the name of Jesus. I don't care how powerful man is. I don't care how much money man has. No name can compare with the name Jesus. His name is above all names. And then, you think the name is powerful? Let's look at the nature. Christ's nature, or his characteristics and his attributes, is beyond all. The name is Jesus. But the nature and the character is Wonderful Counselor. Watch this. When you open up your hearts and make room in your heart for Christ, the Messiah, your life will be free of confusion, because Christ is a wonderful counselor. That word wonderful means that he is full of wonders. He's full of amazement, and he is a great counselor. And so Christ's nature, Christ's name is important, but Christ's nature is equally as important. He's wonderful. Tell someone he's wonderful. I know this year has been rough. It's been difficult. It's been a year of chaos and confusion, but Christ is wonderful, full of wonders. Anyone still believe in the wonders of Christ? Anyone still believe that Christ can do the impossible? Anyone still believe that when Christ shows up, everything that is out of alignment has to come in alignment? Chaos has to go. Confusion has to go. Anyone believes in the wonder of Christ? His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Christ's nature, Bethel, is beyond all. He's a wonderful counselor. The Messiah's kingdom is free from confusion because Christ is a wonderful counselor. Not only is he a wonderful counselor, but as a counselor, he demonstrates wisdom. He demonstrates wisdom as you look at his life as he walked upon the face of the earth. He counseled many. He always knew when to speak and what to say. He knew when to reach out to those who were seeking him. He knew how to respond to an inquisitive mind. He knew how to rebuke a haughty soul. That's a wonderful counselor. Some of us don't know. We deal with everyone the same way all the time. But Christ was a wonderful counselor. He knew how to respond to the needs of people. Even so, in John 7 and 14, the scripture says that even his enemies testify. And they said, never did a man speak that way. This man speaks. That's what the word says. Never. His enemy says, never did a man speak the way this man speaks. He is a wonderful counselor. So in other words, you ought to trust the counsel of God. Many are the plans in the heart of a man. I know but we're preparing for 2022, particularly all of us, all of you young people, you're preparing for it. But the Bible says it's the plans and the counsel of the Lord that prevails. Seek God. Seek. Don't put your plans before him. Seek God and ask him to lay your plans on your heart. Bethel, seek God. Amen. Seek God. We are in a crucial time. We are in a crucial time, crossing over. We are in a crucial time praying for the right pastor. We ought to seek God. God is not interested in the counsel of our own hearts. God is, I know y'all don't want to hear me. I didn't plan to go here today, but I'm going to say it. God is not interested in what we want. God ain't interested in what I want. It's the counsel of the Lord. Whatever the counsel of the Lord is, it is well. Whatever the counsel of the Lord is, it is well. If the counsel of the Lord is, it is well, because he is God. It is well. See, y'all don't like the truth. Y'all don't like the truth. Everybody going quiet on me. Deaconess, everybody going quiet on me. The counsel of the Lord. Not only is it well, but it's perfect. It's perfect. It's just perfect. God knows the future. God knows what Bethel will encounter in the future. God knows what you're going to encounter in the future. That's why you have to trust his counsel on who to marry, what job to take. You have to accept and trust his counsel in your decision making, because he's already in the future. Trust God. Trust the counsel of the Lord. As a counselor, he demonstrates wisdom Secondly, Christ is the source of all truth. I'm about to close. He's the source of all truth. He says in John 14, he said, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. This is what makes him a wonderful counselor. He demonstrates wisdom, and he is the source of all truth. There's no darkness in God. He's the source of all truth. There are no gray areas in God. Light or darkness, right or wrong, honor or dishonor. God is not in between. And God wants hot or cold. The Bible says that God spits out, you know, he spews out of his mouth something, someone that is lukewarm. Choose ye this day who you will serve, Bethel. If it be God, serve God. If it be mammon, serve mammon. But the counsel of God is true. And God is the source of all truth. You want to be blessed? Choose truth. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, not stand in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law, that's the word of the Lord. And in his word and law, that man meditates day and night. And guess what happens? That man becomes planted. I don't want no man plant me. I don't want no woman plant me. I don't want nobody with money plant me. Papa, I don't want it. I'm going to trust the counsel of the Lord. Because when God bless me, no one can take it away from me. When man bless you, man can take away their blessings. When man exalts you, man can pull it down. But God, whom God bless, no man can curse. I remember the children of Israel in the story of Balaam. They sent Balaam to Balaam and said, I can't curse them because they are blessed by God. I'm telling you, be careful. Trust the truth of God. Trust the counsel of God. Run from the counsel a man. Christ's nature is beyond all. He is a wonderful counselor. There's no confusion in him. He is the mighty God. There is no chaos in him. The Messiah's kingdom is free from chaos because he is the mighty God. He is the one who in creation brought order out of chaos. He brings divine alignment to everything that is out of order. 1 Corinthians 14 and 33, God said, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace and love and of a sound mind. And so if your life is in chaos, you ought to make room for God. Spend time with him. Allow your spirit to be formed. Hear from him so that he can be the mighty God. And remove the counselor and remove the chaos as he is the wonderful counselor who removes confusion. As I hasten on, he is the everlasting Father. In comparison to human government, the Messiah's kingdom is uncomplicated because he is the eternal Father. That's what that word is translated. He is the eternal Father. Nothing is too complex for the eternal Father, the creator and the sustainer of everything. I'm saying to you, Bethel, nothing is too complex. Nothing is too difficult. Nothing is too hard for God. Nothing is too hard for the eternal Father, watch, the creator and the sustainer of mankind. Infinity, infinity, and all of his details, his intricacies, are nothing to him who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He is the everlasting Father. In him, there is no complexity. He is the Prince of Peace. No conflicts. In the Messiah's kingdom, there are no conflict because he is the Prince of Peace. God offers peace from God. Romans 1 and 7. He says to all who are his grace. Romans 1 and 7, he offers peace from God to all who are recipients of his grace. If you are a recipient of God's grace, he offers peace to you. Romans 1, 7 says, to all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you. Grace to you. Grace to you and peace from our Lord God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what God wants to speak to you. He wants to speak grace to your household. He wants to speak grace to Bethel. Come on, Bethel, grace to you today. Grace to you. When you receive grace, it means that all things shall be well. It means to take your eyes and your thoughts of what does not look well. But when the grace of God comes, it is sufficient to sustain us. Not only to sustain us, but to help us. God wants to speak grace to you. He offers peace from God. And then he's the Prince of Peace. Romans 5 and 1 says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And so he brings peace with God. He brings peace with God. He brings peace with God. This morning, God wants to offer you peace with him. If you are justified by faith, God gives you peace with him. And lastly, he brings the peace of God. Philippians 4 says, and the peace of God, which passeth all knowledge and understanding, shall keep your hearts and mind through Christ Jesus. And the last verse, which I believe in, Trevor, Isaiah, same chapter, chapter 6, I believe is verse 7. It says, how should all of this be accomplished? And it ends by saying, the zeal of the Lord shall accomplish it. The zeal of the Lord of hosts shall perform this. When we talk about the Lord's zeal, you know, it speaks about the commitment of the Lord. The zeal of the Lord speaks about the love of God. The zeal of the Lord is also translated the anger and the envy of God. So in other words, God loves his people so much that every promise, y'all hear me as I close, every promise he has made to you and me, every promise he has made to your family down to the third and the fourth generation, how should all of it be accomplished? The zeal of the Lord of hosts, the armies of the Lord, that's what it means. The armies of the Lord will fight for you when you're sleeping. The armies of the Lord will fight for you when you don't even know what's going on around you. The zeal of the Lord shall accomplish it. Bethel, hear me. As we transition into 2022, trust God. Trust the God of Advent. Trust Christ in Christmas, but also trust the plans of God. You have to trust the plans of God. You got to put your trust in God. You got to know that he is the eternal God. You have to know that he is a God who cannot fail. He will not fail you. You have to trust God. You don't have to worry how it's going to come together. The zeal of the Lord shall accomplish it. We don't have to put our hands in nothing. Bible says that God, he fights against the ungodly. And I'm not talking about no pastorship here. I'm talking about life. Do what is right. Do what is right. Scripture says that. What it says? He will rule upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it. Look, with judgment and justice. Another version said with righteousness and fairness. You want to be blessed as you go into 2021. 2022, thank you. God wants you to do, you and I, to do what is right. Do what is right. Trust the truth of the Lord. And God will judge us. He will allow righteousness
and fairness to come to each and every one of you. The kingdom of heaven is at hand today. I know I said a lot, and it was a teaching message, but the reality is it was a message to challenge us. It was a message to challenge us to go forward. It was a message to challenge us to stop doing some of the stuff that we're doing that is unpleasing in the sight of God, that is not useful, it's not beneficial. But if you hear God, I believe that the Spirit of the Lord will minister to you and take you to another place, a new place, allow you to experience a new place in Him as you prepare for 2022. How shall it be accomplished? You get nothing to worry about. The seal of the Lord shall accomplish it. Amen.
We prepare now to go before God in prayer. And so we ask you to just bow your heads and to close your eyes at this time. You have heard, you have sat, you have taken in, and you know what you need to do with what you have heard. We thank God for how He has spoken. We thank God for Reverend Christina, His messenger today. And we thank God for the hearts that have been prepared and that are now receptive to take with them out of this service what needs to be embraced uniquely by them. So God, we come before you, thanking you on this last Sunday in this year. We are not presumptuous that we know that we are going to see January the 1st. We dare not be presumptuous in thinking that the end of this day is a foregone conclusion. Only you know the end from the beginning. So God, help us to trust you, even where we cannot trace you. We give our hearts to you. We surrender fully to you, so that you will be Lord in our lives and not just Savior on our lips. God, forgive us where we have erred. Strengthen us where we are weak. Help Christians to fall in love with other Christians again. Bring spouses back together. Bring wayward children back to their families. And cause us, O God, by the way we treat people, by the way we speak to people, and by the way we behave, evidence that you are indeed Lord in our lives. Heal our bodies. Restore what the years of difficulty has depleted financially. And then, O God, after doing all that, in the midst of what we are now going through, give us peace. Give us your peace, O Prince of Peace. Amen.
God bless you. Let us prepare now for our closing hymn as we prepare to dismiss. Our moderator will come at this time and lead us in our closing hymn.
Thank God for the preaching moment we had this morning. Indeed, our hearts did burn. And I've had the benefit of having two sermons this morning, and they were so centered on Christ, Jesus. I don't know whether they communicated with each other, but somehow there was a dovetailing and a wonderful combination of circumstances. So we give God thanks that the message of Christ in Christmas and the light of the world in Christ is still being proclaimed and still being declared, so that men and women in our time and throughout all ages will hear of this great gospel. So we give God thanks. We also give God thanks as we close out this year. Isn't it amazing? I think we still have not come to the realization that our pastor's chair is still empty. We still have a lot of pain, a lot of mourning, and a lot of sorrow in our hearts. But God has come, as Reverend Christina has reminded us, to bring light. Rise, shine, for thy light is come. And whilst we close out this year, and whilst we close out this period of mourning, we are ever mindful of the fact that after 39 years, we've had a great pastor and someone who has left us a wonderful legacy to follow and to emulate. Whilst we close out, as it were, formally this period of mourning, we do not close out on our memories and the joy and the wonderful teachings and preachings that we have been part of and shared throughout these many years. We give God thanks, and we pray that as we continue to remember his family, that God would continue to bestow upon us great light and great awakening, because we move into a new period of transition. We move into a new situation. The God who was with us in the past, Brother Toby, do you think he's going to be with us as we carry on? God has been our God throughout all generations. So you could rest assured that that God who is immutable, unchangeable, unstoppable, will continue to lead. Lead on, O King Eternal. So rejoice, my brothers, as you go from this place, and as we say farewell to 2021, we give God thanks. This is our final Sunday here. We thank God that we have throughout the years been able to celebrate and to honor God. We will continue to honor him in our lives, in how we live, in how we communicate with each other, and in the things that we do, and into the very difficult task that we have ahead of. And as we were reminded again by Reverend Christina, we will seek the counsel of our God. He is the wonderful counselor, the everlasting God, and he is the Prince of Peace. We will rely on that. So with those words, let us stand together and sing our closing hymn. Hark, the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King.
unto God as we give the benediction. And now unto the King Eternal, immortal, invincible, the only wise God, the Lord of the church, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Join us for one of the following auxiliary meetings. Teen Talk Bahamas every Friday at 6 p.m. on Facebook Live at Global 99.5 or on radio at Global 99.5 FM. Prayer meeting every Saturday at 7 a.m. and Children's Church on December 19th at 11:30 a.m. Special prayers are requested for Sister Bernice Ballard, Sister Mia Charlton, Brother Bruce Delancey, Evangelist Alfreda Lightborn, Sister Charlene Lightborn, Sister Anita Maycock, Sister Ruth Miller, Sister Mia Smith, and Sister Casey Williams. As we assemble together week after week, we are constantly mindful and prayerful for the sick and shut-in of this nation and of this church. Special prayers are requested for Dorothy Carey, Edward Fitzgerald, Dorothy Hanna, Sheila Hepburn, Jenny Hinsey, Sally Hutchinson, Barbara Jones, Constance Mackey, Sylvia Munnings, Marjorie Murphy, Charlene Neely, Antoinette Pinder, Shambula Pinder, Carmetta Ramming, Francis Richards, Maxine Rule, Sarah Rule, Sydney Stirrup, Notland Simmons, Isabel Strawn, Murtis Sweeting, Jennifer Utiel Rule, Carly Wilson, Lillian Wilson, Marie Winters, and Antoinette Wiley. Warm birthday greetings are extended to Tanisha Moss, Rosetta Pinder, Kirk Moxey, D'Angela Delancey, Aspenique Demerit, Evangelist Sterling Moss, Aidan Austin, Debbie Ferguson, Presley Gaudette, Matthew Ambrister, and Latoya Knowles. Enjoy your day! Warm anniversary greetings are extended to Brother Samuel and Sister Zenobia Kelly as they celebrate 20 years of marriage, and Reverend A. DeWitt and Sister Lori Hutchison, who celebrate 26 years of marriage. May God continue to richly bless and strengthen your union. The church's office will be closed during the Christmas season from Monday, December 20th, 2021 to Monday, January 3rd, 2022, and will reopen on Tuesday, January 4th at 9 a.m. If you should have an emergency or need assistance, please feel free to call or WhatsApp 323-5000. Bethel will hold two watch night services on Friday, December 31st, 2021 at 8 p.m. and 10:30 p.m. We ask that all members fill out a watch night form indicating which service they will be attending and how many persons. The form can be filled out and submitted on the church's website at historicbethelbaptist.org, or a form can be obtained from Bethel's information desk in the foyer of the church, filled out and given to an usher or sent to Lisa or Sharika via WhatsApp at 323-5000 or the church's email, bethelbaptist1790@gmail.com. An email or WhatsApp will be sent to you confirming receipt of your form. Please note that once we would have met our protocol requirements for a particular service, we will not be accepting any more forms for that service. The watch night service will be streamed live via the church's website and Facebook if you are unable to attend. We thank you for your cooperation in this matter. You and your family are cordially invited to attend both or one of our New Year's services on Sunday, January 2nd at 7:45 a.m. or 10:45 a.m. Let us come together as one family in Christ and worship the Lord our God. Bring every member of your family and invite your neighbors and friends for a grand time in the Lord.
We invite you to join us this Sunday at our 7:45 a.m. or 11 o'clock a.m. worship service. If you are unable to join us in person, please tune in to our live stream at www.historicbethelbaptist.org or on Facebook at Historic Bethel Baptist. For more information, please contact the church's office at 323-5000.